the Lord, for it is good to sing praises unto our God.
Amen.
For it is pleasant, and praise is comely, or the word comely means it's right. It's the right thing to do, right?
Yeah.
The Lord doth build up Jerusalem, and he gathereth together the outcast of Israel. How many know he's been doing that for several years now?
Right.
And he's bringing back the Jewish people to Israel. He heals the brokenhearted, right? I say that about Israel because you can see that, right? You can see that happening. And then we say he heals the brokenhearted, right? If you're brokenhearted here this morning, God is here, and he is ready, willing, and able to heal your broken heart. Just like he can bring back the Jewish people out of every land that they've been scattered to, he can heal your broken heart this morning. He can tell the number of the stars, and he calleth them by name. Great is our Lord, and of great power, and his understanding is infinite. The Lord lifts up the meek, and he casts down the wicked to the ground. Right? The question is are you up or are you on the ground?
Uh-oh.
Right? How many know you can change? Right, that's called repent, right? We change our mind, right? So if you're on the ground, change your mind. Sing unto the Lord with thanksgiving. Sing praise upon the harp or the guitar, right? Unto our God, who covereth the heavens with clouds, who prepareth rain for the earth, who makes grass to grow upon the mountains. He giveth to the beast his food and to the young ravens which cry. He delighteth not in the strength of the horse, and he taketh no pleasure in the legs of a man. The Lord takes pleasure in them that fear him, in those who hope in his mercy. I mean, we need to have a fear of the Lord, right? We don't need to be terrified of him, but we need to have a fear. Right, he's not our buddy. He's not the man upstairs.
Right.
Amen. How many know he is the very God of very God? There is none other. He is holy. He is not like us. He is worthy of all of our praise. Amen. He's worthy of you rolling out of bed in the morning and coming to worship him. Amen. He's worthy of us shaking off the tiredness and the getting the stuff out of our eyes and overcoming that feeling of I just want to sit down, I don't want to do nothing, I don't want to be here. Amen. We're going to make a choice, right? We're going to praise God because he is worthy, worthy, worthy of our praises. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, O Jerusalem, and praise God, O Zion. Father God, we just come before you this morning, Lord God. And Father, we just shake ourselves this morning, Lord. We're not wanting to take you for granted. Lord God, we are coming into the presence of complete holiness. We are coming into the presence of majesty. We are coming into the presence of royalty this morning, Lord God. Father, we bow our necks before you, Lord God. We bow our knee before you, Lord God. Father, we respectfully approach your throne this morning, Lord God, because you are worthy, worthy, worthy. You are the Lamb, Lord Jesus, who was slain for the sins of the world. Lord, you have done us a service far beyond our words could tell, Lord God, could convey. Lord, you are worthy of our praise. And we come before you in praise and thanksgiving and adoration this morning in the mighty and the matchless name of Jesus of Nazareth. Amen and amen and amen. Let's worship the Lord together.
Our hands to give you the glory.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen, amen.
We praise you, Lord.
Of course, we can lift up our hands anywhere. Amen. Praise God.
Time.
But there's just something special about God's people coming together in the name of Jesus, lifting up holy hands. Praise God. Hallelujah. Because who can tell what God might do this morning?
Yes. Amen.
I mean, I'm sure they all didn't have any kind of an idea at all when they all gathered themselves together in that upper room. He just said, you guys just need to get together up there. And I'm sure they wasn't playing bingo.
No, they were praising their God.
Did I say that?
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. I'm sure they began worshiping. Amen. And when you just lift up your hands and begin to worship God, amen. The Lord does miracles. Does miracles. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah.
God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise the Lamb of God. I believe Paul admonishes us in, I believe it's in the book of Galatians, to not grow weary in well-doing. Amen. Just do the next right thing. Just take the next step. Just do know what you just do what you know to do. Amen. Praise God. Stay in the Word. Lift up your hands. Praise Him. Thank you, Jesus. Love your neighbor. Love him. You know, learn. It's about learning more ways of loving God. Amen. What can we do? It's not all about God pleasing us. It's about us pleasing God. Lord, what can I do for you? Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Still being moved.
Thank you, Lord.
Strongholds are still. here for you, oh God. Cry, oh God. We need you to move, oh God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Break the chains, oh God, that bind us. Hallelujah. We need a move, oh God. Hallelujah. It can't be business as usual, God. We need you. Hallelujah. Break into our business, oh God. Break into our country, oh God. Break into our church, oh God.
Hallelujah. We need to move. Amen. We need to move. Hallelujah. I want you to know we're in revival. Amen. We're in revival. How do you know, Pastor Mike? Well, how many know the devil is never leading anything? Amen. How many know he's always responding to what God is doing? Right? He didn't lead Jesus into the crucifixion and all of that. How many know Jesus was led into the wilderness by the Spirit of God?
That's right.
Amen. If the devil would have known, right, that he was crucifying the Lord of glory, he wouldn't have done it. How many know he was reacting everywhere that he went to what God was doing? Right. How many know what's going on in our world today is a reaction to what God is doing?
Right.
How many know God is moving? Yes. Revival is happening. Now, what is revival?
Right.
How many know revival is not when the world gets right? How many know revival is when the church gets right?
Right.
Amen. How many know the Spirit of God is moving? Yes. The song says, Lord, move. How many know God wants to move? Amen. God wants to perform His word. God wants to do exactly what He said He was going to do, but He needs a man. He needs a woman. He needs somebody to go along with him. Amen. He needs some folks that are willing to let go of the garbage that they've been messing with and the garbage that they've been living in. Quit acting like they're all Christian and all of this when they live like the devil 6.5 days of the week. And they need to repent. Amen. If we're going to have revival in America, if we're going to have revival in the world, it's because the church is going to repent. Amen. How many know 2 Chronicles chapter 7 verse 14? Many of you could quote it. If my people. Amen. Who's his people? He's not talking about the world. He's not talking about the devil crowd. Right? He's talking about my people, which are called by my name. Amen. Right? How many know most of us would put ourselves in that category? I'm his people. I am called by His name. Yes. It says, if we will humble ourselves. Amen. We started the service this morning, right? We started this service this morning by saying that we need to fear God. Right? We need to respect God. Right? We need to quit treating Him like He's just our buddy on the block. Amen. He is our elder brother, and He does want to come and love on us and be near us and to be known by us. But He is still God.
Yes.
He is still the very God of very God.
Thank you, Lord.
And when you start getting close to somebody and when you start taking advantage of somebody, right, when you start getting familiar with them, you start taking advantage of them, right? Well, they don't really know. They really don't know what that, you know, what they're saying, they don't really mean it, right? God says to do this, but He doesn't really mean it, right? So I can just do whatever I want to do, and we start taking God for granted when we're not respecting Him, right? We got to come back to that place where we humble ourselves, right? Humble ourselves. Step number one with being a Christian is admitting that we're wrong. Right? If you're waiting for God to admit that He's wrong, you're going to wait for a long, 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 long time.
Amen.
God is not wrong. Yes. Right? We are wrong. Amen. And we have to humble ourselves. Right? Many of us in this room have gotten to a place in our Christian life where God said, lay it down.
Lay it down.
And you said no.
Lord, help us.
You said no. and you quit progressing because you said no. And the Spirit of the Lord is saying, humble yourself. Humble yourself. Right? I could tell you that what's on the other side of that obedience is going to blow your mind.
Yeah.
But that's not the reason why you need to do it. You need to humble yourself because God said to humble yourself. God said, don't touch that thing that you've been touching. And he says, humble yourself, right? Humble themselves and pray. How many know the church is in a bad spot when it comes to prayer? There's a whole lot of folks that are called by his name that don't know how to pray. Right? All you need to do is go somewhere and say, hey, brother, sister, would you pray? And that's just like praying over the food kind of prayer. Not a how to get the devil off your dishes kind of prayer. How to get the devil out of your life kind of prayer. How to tell the devil to get out of my house, get out of my family, get out of my country, get out of my church. Amen. A warfare prayer. Amen. That walks the floor in the middle of the night that says, I'm not going to sleep. I'm going to call down heaven right now. I'm going to run the devil out of this situation. Right? The Lord has shown me that my kids are going the wrong way. And I'm here to tell them, devil, you can't have them. And I'm going to walk the floor. And I'm going to pray until they're back in the kingdom of God. Amen. I mean, know this church that we're a part of, the Church of Jesus Christ, it is the answer for the whole world. It is the answer for the whole world. All right? They'll humble themselves and pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways. Then I will hear from heaven. We got a whole lot of wicked ways, right? I'm not talking about all the folks out there. I'm talking about all us folks in here, right? We eat the same stuff they eat out there. We listen to the same stuff that they listen to out there. We do most all of the same things that they do out there. But then we act like we're different. Amen. The Bible says, separate yourself. Come out from among them and be holy like I am holy, God says. Amen. Right? It's not a downer, so to speak. How many know there's a solution for it? We just need to repent. But how many know revival starts with repentance?
Thank you, Jesus.
Right? If you want to see this world change, it's going to start with repentance. Right? How many know revival starts in the circle that you draw around you? And say, God, I want revival right here, God. I want my life to change, Lord God. God, I'm the one in need of prayer, Lord God. God, I'm the one that has touched the unclean thing, Lord God. God, I'm the one that has unclean lips, Lord God. God, I'm the one that takes pleasure in wickedness and wrongdoing, Lord God. God, I repent, Lord God. God, I'm not worried about the world. I'm not worried about everybody out there right now. Lord, save me. Restore me. Replenish me, Lord God. Amen. How many know that's revival? Amen. Let's do that this morning. Amen. I don't believe the Holy Spirit is saying what he's saying here today, that he doesn't have a plan for the whole entire service all the way down to the end to get us on a fresh start, to get us going in the direction that we need to go, because there's a world out there, they're tired of argument, right? All you got to do is flip on the radio, the television, your Facebook, whatever, and it's argument, 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 argument. This world is ready for demonstration. It's ready for the demonstration of the power of God. It's ready for the city leaders to sit there and say, well, we can't argue against this miracle. We've known this man to be laid at the gate beautiful for 40 years. And he's walking and he's leaping and he's praising God. We can't argue against this blind man. We know that he's been blind all of his life. And we've never known anybody to be born blind to get their sight back. This is a miracle. Gamaliel said, I'm here to tell you, I wouldn't be fighting against these folks. If this isn't God, it'll go away. But if not, you don't want to be fighting against God. How many know the Jesus in you is the answer to the problems out there in this world? Amen? Amen. Trump's not going to change it. Biden's not going to change it. No special program or plan is going to change it. We are ripe for revival. Right. Amen. How many revival comes when it is darkest outside? We ought to get excited about it. It's getting darker and darker and darker outside, and we just need to repent. We need to get the gunk out of us. So, you know, Jesus said if you're going to remove the speck out of somebody's eye, you got to get the beam out of your eye. Amen. And that should be our focus. Lord Jesus, get the beam out of my eye, Lord God. Hallelujah. I think we should sing that song again. And if you would like to find a place of prayer, I'm not asking for the prayer team to come forward. This is an altar. Right? This is an altar. And an altar is where you meet God. And if you've got something that you would like to discuss with God as they're singing this song, I encourage you to step out of your seat and come find a place around this altar and pray. Amen. How do I repent? Lord Jesus, I am a sinner in need of forgiveness of sin. 1 John 1:9 says that if I confess my sin, you are faithful and just to forgive me of my sin and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. If you've been having a hard time sleeping, right, I encourage you to come pray. If everything in your world is falling apart, I encourage you to pray. Right, I'm not talking to people all the way there on the back row. I'm not talking to people that just come in here every once in a while. I'm talking to everybody in the room this morning. Right, if you've got things, it's time to come lay them down. Amen. Jesus is coming. He's coming back very soon. Let's see.
Now
When we repent, when we turn, that times of refreshing will come from the Lord. You may be seated. Times of refreshing, right? Some of you need some refreshing. Some of you feel rode hard and put up wet. You feel like the hound of hell has been nipping at your heels, and you've been running, and you've been running, and you've been running, and you've been running, and you're tired. Repentance, right? It's not that God needs to come in right now and fix everything. You need to turn. You need to turn. You need to call upon the name of the Lord. Well, I did that, Pastor Mike. I did that years and years ago. But yeah, but now things are different right now. Right? It's time to repent. Get the bar of soap out. It's time. You need to be cleansed. 1 John 1:9, if you confess your sin, He is faithful and just to forgive you and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Amen. God is putting together an army. I can't get past this scripture, and then we're going to move on. We're going to move. Matthew 24:30. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn. And they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. Why would they mourn? They're not ready. They're not ready. How are they going to be ready? It's us. It's the Church of Jesus Christ. Amen. It's our finest hour. Right? It's time. It's time. Right? There may have been time for sleeping, right? If we can go to a firehouse, right? They're all in their beds sleeping. But when the alarm goes, they jump out of bed into their boots and down the pole and into the truck because it's time. I'm here to tell you, it's time. It's time. This scripture goes on to say, learn a parable about a fig tree. I mean, I know there's a fig tree over in the Middle East. Right. And the Bible says that when you see that fig tree come alive, verse 34, verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled. Amen. Now, there's different views of the fig tree as far as when it, some are 48, some are 67, pastor's 49. As far as his age, his birth year, that's all I'm saying. I'm a 67 These generations will not pass until all things are fulfilled. So it's not silly. It's not like the days of old, maybe, to stand up here and say Jesus is coming. That he's right on the doorstep. He's right there. He's standing in the doorway of heaven. He is ready to step out into the clouds. That is not crazy to say with all of the things that have gone on in our world, all of the signs that are there. That is not crazy to say. Jesus is coming. But we need to be ready, because we need to reach every single person that we can, because when they see him, when they're not ready, they're going to mourn. They're going to mourn. Praise the Lord. Father God, we just thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Father, we pray that you would stir us, Lord God. Father, stir us to repentance, Lord God. Bring us to that place, Lord God. Perfect your church, Lord Jesus, so that we can walk in the power, Lord God. So that we can manifest your spirit, Lord God. So that we can stop the mouths of foolish arguments, Lord God. And declare that Jesus is Lord through the power of the Spirit, Lord God.
Thank you.
Father, we thank you for this service. We thank you for what you have in store. We are eagerly awaiting what is coming. Lord God, speak to our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. We want to welcome you to the house of prayer this morning. If this is your very first time, we're glad that you're here. Hallelujah. So if this is your first time, if you'd raise your hand real high, we have a special gift that we'd love to give you. All right. We've got folks back there. Hallelujah. And all I can say is we're not into playing church. We're into being church. Amen. We are the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. His Spirit lives here in us. Amen. And when we come together, the body of the Lord Jesus comes together and amazing things happen. Amen. We were praying in the children's ministries this morning at a little after 9, and we were declaring the presence of the anointing of the Holy Spirit in every area of this building, every area of this ministry, right? Because it is the anointing of the Holy Spirit that breaks every yoke. Amen. And I want to tell you this morning, if you came in here and you've got problems, you don't have to leave with those problems, right? You are sitting under the anointing of the Holy Spirit right now. But you have to move, right? You have to make a move, because if you don't move, you'll walk right out the door, right? It's here to break it off of you right now. There is a window of opportunity right now to walk free from that nonsense that's been bothering you all your life, but you got to move. You're going to stop. Thank you, Jesus. We want to welcome everybody that's tuning in on Facebook this morning. Amen. We're glad that you're there. If you're within 100 miles, come be here. Amen. Join together with us here. Hallelujah. But we're glad that you're here, and the same Spirit that's right here right now is right there where you are, and I hope that you receive this as well. If you've got stuff going on in your life, repent. Repent in Jesus' name. How do I do that? You call upon the name of the Lord. You say who you are. Lord God, I'm messed up. I need a Savior in my life. I am a sinner. I'm in need of a Savior. Come into my life, Lord Jesus. Be the Lord and the Savior of my life. Devil, I'm not yours anymore. And Jesus, Holy Spirit, I will follow wherever you lead me to go. Right? You pray a prayer something like that, meaning it from your heart. The Holy Spirit will take care of the rest. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Well, we want to invite the Hope News team to come and tell us the announcements that we have. Amen.
Hi. Oh. Good morning, House of Prayer.
Sorry, Joel. That's all I had.
Thank you.
House of Prayer, Ellisville, June 28th. Here we go. Marks of a True Christian. The final class will be today at 4 p.m. Please see Pastor Tony if you have any questions. Cell phone ban, July 1st. Uh-oh. I don't know if you haven't heard or not, but please note that a new law was passed, and starting next week on July 1st, you can no longer use your cell phone to call or text while driving. We want to make sure that you are all safe out there, so keep that in mind. I think it's like a $500 fine or something crazy like that, so probably not worth it. Oh, van drivers are needed. We need van drivers, people that are willing to help pick up people for church and not use their cell phone. Please see Pastor Larry if you want to volunteer. We will need a copy of your driver's license and some information from you, so please see Pastor Jeanette for those details. Now, the prayer line has a new email address. It's prayer.request@thehop-e.com. If you have any requests, please email to the above address or visit our website at thehop-e.com, where you can fill out a form on the bottom of the webpage, or you can text your request to 812-320-5047. Prayer works, so it's worth the text message. Amazon Smile, if you have shopped on Amazon, or if you still shop on Amazon, you can give via Amazon Smile. For more information, please go to our website, www.thehop-e.com. Also, an information sheet on how to set this up is available at the information station, so check it out. Another way to give is community rewards. You can link your Kroger card to the church, and they'll be able to raise money at no cost to you for Kids Camp. There is now an information packet at the information station for help setting up your account. You can also speak to the Kroger customer service desk if you need additional information. Check out our new redesigned website at thehop-e.com. We provide our live streaming on the website as well as Facebook and Boxcast. Who We Are in Christ prayer meeting. That meets every Saturday at 3 p.m. in the kitchen downstairs. Please see Bonita if you have any questions. Okay, we got our normal lineup of regularly scheduled services. Monday night Bible study, 7 p.m. on Monday night. We got Wednesday night Bible study, is also at 7 p.m., the midweek refuel. And then you're here, of course, for the Sunday morning service at 10 a.m. So thanks for joining us. And teens can be dismissed. You guys are out of here. Go hang out with Pastor Joel. Have a great day.
All right. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Well, we want to celebrate your birthday.
Yeah.
Right? If you had a birthday in the month of June, we encourage you, come on down. We're going to celebrate your birthday this morning. Hallelujah. Birthdays in June. Come on down. You got to tell us your name, how old you are, when your birthday was in the month of June.
Anthony Fox, and I'm celebrating 22 years free from alcohol and drugs today.
Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord, Anthony.
I'm Bobby. I turned 61 on the 15th.
Yay! Yay.
I'm Shelly, and I turned 53 on the 5th.
I'm Danny.
And I turned 52 on June 7th.
I'm Little Debbie, and I turned 67 on the 9th.
I'm JR, and I turned double nickel on the 6th.
I'm Brianna, and I turned 13 on the 26th.
I'm Dana, and I turned 15 on the 19th.
All right. I'm Pastor Larry, and I turned 71 on the 7th.
All right. Let's sing happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. A happy birthday to you.
May you feel Jesus near. Every day of the year. A happy birthday to you. A happy birthday to you. And the best year you've ever had.
All right. Anniversary. Celebrating an anniversary this morning. Come on down. We want to celebrate your anniversary. Anniversary. Yeah, that's my grandson. Anniversary. Please tell us your name and what it is that you're celebrating and how many years.
I'm Jaima, and Jerry and I will celebrate 58 years of marriage
on
June 30th.
Hallelujah.
Terry and Pat, and we've been married 21 years on Friday the 26th.
We've also been members of House of Prayer for 21 years.
So. All right. Woo.
I'm Tammy, and this is Steve, and we've been married 55 years. Hey, I'm sorry, it's 5.
I'm Spencer, this is my wife Brittany. We've been married 4 years on the 4th.
All right.
I'm Jake, and this is Brianna, and it was how many years? 1 year on the 19th.
Yeah. Yay! Let's sing happy anniversary.
Happy anniversary to you. A happy anniversary to you. May you feel Jesus near. Every day of the year. A happy anniversary to you. A happy anniversary to you. And the best you ever had.
Amen, amen. Excited for what God is doing. Amen. Hallelujah. God gives us life. God gives us wonderful relationships. Pastor has a special presentation that he would like to make this morning.
Right.
Can you say God is good?
God is good.
Amen, amen. You know, I just want to ditto everything that Pastor Mike was saying this morning. We are living at the twilight, if you want to call it that, or the midnight hour, or Jesus is coming back soon. Amen. Amen. And so if you've had it in neutral, get it in overdrive. Amen. You know, when the Lord comes back, I want him to catch me doing something. He said, now this worries me. He says, when I come back, will I find any faith? Will I find any faith? I don't want to be a part of the church of the Laodicea bunch, but I want to be a part of that Philadelphia bunch. Amen. That just renews my love towards the Lord every single day. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Well, you know, it's all about keeping on, keeping on. And I want to recognize a very special person to all of us that's been an example for many years now. And that is our brother, Craig Cassidy. He has diligently pursued the Lord with all of his heart. And he's just receiving his 20-year 20-year patch and being a part of Unchained Ministries, being a part of the Unchained Gang, and Craig, you have been a faithful servant. You've been a delight to serve with, and we just thank you for your example. We know that you go through stuff like everybody else, but you know what? You'd never know it. You just keep on putting one foot in front of the other, and that's what we admire about you, and we want to thank you. Amen.
Wow. 20 years. 20 years. That just means I'm getting old.
Yeah.
20. My kids are 20. So, oh my goodness. But no, I could. I'm surprised, but I'm thankful, and really, this is just. I mean, I'm thankful to you guys. Because, I mean, I'm just show up. That's all I do.
That's it.
And if you didn't have this ministry, you know, it's kind of helped keep me in line. Yeah. You know, I mean, I struggle and go through things, like you said, all the time. And I just keep coming back.
That's it.
So,
that's what you do.
It's not anything that I've done, but I appreciate what you guys have done for me.
Thank you, Craig. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Well, we want to continue our worship with our giving this morning. So if you have brought the tithe, if you have an offering to give, if you'll stand with us. Hallelujah. Take the tithe, the offering. If you're doing it electronically, you can text to 84321. Text the amount to 84321. You can use the church app. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Declare with me, I bring my tithe,
I bring my tithe
into the storehouse,
into the storehouse,
that there may be plenty,
that there may be plenty.
And God says,
and God says,
He will open the windows of heaven,
He will open the windows of heaven,
and pour me out a blessing,
and pour me out a blessing.
How big?
So big.
I won't be able to receive it all,
to receive.
And God says,
and God says,
He will rebuke the devourer,
He will rebuke the devourer
for my sake,
so that all nations
will call you blessed. You are blessed in Jesus' name. Amen. Give us unto the Lord this morning. Bless these tithe and offerings.
Lord, Heavenly Father, Lord, just bless this offering, Lord. Just bless it and do what you've given it to, Lord. And Lord, just thank you, Lord, for giving it to us so we can give it to you, Lord. Just thank you for everything we're doing, everything we've been doing.
Amen. 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 You may be seated. Hallelujah. We have an awesome treat for you this morning. Our sister Karen Freeman has a word hot from heaven for us, and I'm going to get out of her way quickly. Hallelujah. God bless you.
I feel like we've already had a lot of that this morning. I'm not sure I've got much left to say, but I will say now that all hearts are clear, we'll move on to the next step, right? Glad to be here. I, of course, you know, we haven't been here for a while, and so I haven't really had a chance to give you my thoughts of the COVID, so I want to share that with you if you'll put that picture up for me. This was in the Herald Times on Resurrection Sunday. And I thought only God could take a pandemic, turn it around, and get He is risen on the front page of bold letters of the Bloomington newspaper. People weren't in church, but the word still went out. That's how big God is. So I took a picture of that when it happened, and I was like, you know what, if this is what COVID does, then come on, COVID, come right on in. Come right on in, because if you won't come to here, if people won't come here, then we'll bring it to you. And God will use whatever He has to do it. And I'm just so thankful for that. Thank you for putting that up. I appreciate it. I'm going to try to move quickly and watch the time here. We're going to be talking about three different people, Elijah, Joseph, and a little bit of Joshua, and I'll try to move quickly. I want to look at some things that they each had in common. And like I said, now that all our hearts are clear, we've had an opportunity to clean out all that stuff that shouldn't be there. What's the next step? What's next? The name Elijah means my God, Jehovah, is He. I like that. And we don't know much about Elijah, but I want to lay a little groundwork of where we first see Elijah. For a little over 100 years, Israel was ruled by three kings, Saul, David, and Solomon. And they weren't perfect men, but they did lead the way for Israel to be a Christian nation, or a godly nation that served God, Jehovah. And again, they weren't perfect in their own natural lives. They weren't. They made mistakes. They did things wrong, and don't we all? And that was okay. But at the end of Solomon's reign, his son, Rehoboam and Jeroboam, there was a little struggle there, and a civil war kind of ensued. I encourage you to go to Kings and read about it. Not going to spend a lot of time there, but Israel was divided into the northern tribes and the southern tribes, 10 northern and 2 southern. And both of these fell into foreign hands and into foreign invaders because of their idolatry. They just continued to move farther and farther and farther away from God. Now, for the next 200 years, there were about 19 kings. And you can read all about them. They don't give us a lot of information. They'll usually say, so-and-so reigned 20 years and he did evil in the sight of the Lord. Or so-and-so reigned 10 years and he did what was right in the sight of the Lord. But mainly evil. They got away from God. And Jeroboam, who reigned for 22 years, kind of set that standard. So they go through lots of kings, and you can read that, like I said, in 1 Kings. And along comes Ahab. Now, the Bible tells us in Kings, and I want to read it. Ahab is now the king, and he, the Bible says, did evil in the sight of the Lord above all that were before him. Now, that's pretty evil. So all those 19 or 20 kings before him who did evil, he was now the most evil, worst of all. And to make it matters even worse, he had a wife by the name of Jezebel who doubled that wickedness because she promoted Baal across the land. Now, idolatry was always there. It was always in little groves here and patches there. But she really pushed it to the forefront. And this became one of the main gods that the Israelites began to worship. And in verse 33 of 1 Kings chapter 16, it says, "And Ahab made a grove, and Ahab did more to provoke the Lord God of Israel to anger than all the kings of Israel that were before him." Now, you got to get God pretty mad when you say,
his anger was greater than it had ever been against anybody else. That he, Ahab, provoked God. And God said, I've had enough. I'm done. And he drops Elijah into the middle of this. Picture poor Elijah now. The prophet of God, he's been dropped into this place of where Israel had never been more away from God than they were at this point. They had never been farther away. And here God is calling him as the prophet of God and drops him into this mess. And he says, I want you to go see Ahab. Okay. He goes to see Ahab. This isn't a new story. And he says it's not going to rain for a while. The point I want to get to on that is as soon as he says that, here's what Elijah said. He says to Ahab, as the Lord, the God of Israel, lives. He made it very clear who was sending this message. It wasn't Elijah, and it wasn't the prophets over here standing, and it wasn't a group of men, a committee somewhere, or the board of deacons and elders. He says, God says, there's not going to be dew nor rain these years except by my word. He gets Ahab's attention by proclaiming, this is God talking, the living God, the only God. You better heed the word. Ahab pays little attention, and as you know, the story goes, he makes this statement, and then he disappears. He's gone. So God has given him a plan. God's told him what's going to happen. He says, I'm going to use you. I want you to go. Elijah knew what his job was. He went and did that job, and now he's waiting. God says, I want you to go over here by the brook Cherith, which means cut off. And he waits. That's what we're going to talk about today, waiting, because we hate to wait. We just hate to wait. When I look at the people in the Bible, I always try to put myself in their shoes, and I think, how would I react to that? What would I do if I were Elijah? Well, one, I might be very happy because I'm out of the anger of the king. This evil king, God has set me over here by the brook. I'm safe. I'm protected. He's provided me water. He's providing me food. I don't have to worry about the rage of Ahab and his wife Jezebel. He might have been very relieved. I've went. I've stirred up the nest. The hornets are mad. I'm getting out of here. He might have been a little bit embarrassed. Well, wait a minute. I thought God was going to use me in a mighty way. I thought God had put this great call on my life, and I'm going to go out, and I'm going to see sin, and I'm going to defeat it, and I'm going to proclaim the word of God, and the whole nation's going to fall to their knees and repent, and it's all going to be because of me following the word of God. He might have thought, people must think I'm a coward. I've went in, and then I ran. We don't like to be embarrassed. We don't like to think people are talking bad about us. Where'd you go, you chicken? Where you at, Elijah? He might have been mad. Hey, I want to be in the middle of the action, and here I am over by a brook all by myself. I'm waiting. He was probably confused. Wait a minute, I thought you had a mission for me. I thought I had a job. I thought there was something I was going to be doing. And what I see him doing is he's got a path worn here by Pastor Mike. He's praying and praying and praying and praying, and he's saying, when God, when God, when God, when is it going to be my turn to move in this? When are you going to say go? When are you going to say, here's what I want you to do? What's the problem, God? Did I miss that? Did I not hear it? If you have been given a job to do and it's not come to pass yet, don't worry about it. It's okay. There are things that God is arranging and fixing and doing in the background that you can't see. And when the time is right, when it's God's time, things will begin to happen. But until then, there are lessons to be learned. There are things that God is preparing in you to provide you and prepare you for the next step in your walk, the next journey. If you've been called to the ministry and you think overnight you're going to have a church of 500, and, you know, you're going to be on TV, and when it doesn't happen in 6 months, you're going, wow, God, I thought I was called. You probably are called. You're still called. But it's not God's time yet. There are things you need to learn. There are things you need to experience. There are growths you need to take. But we get impatient. We want to know, why isn't it happening? And Elijah waited 3 years. I can barely wait 3 weeks. I'm serious. It's hard for me. I once took a job, and they told me the reason I was hired for the job was for not the position I was hired into, but for the next step up, and I knew that.
And I got impatient. I was like, oh, well, when's this going to happen? I thought, well, by week two, surely they would have made this promotion. They've already told me that's what's going to happen. It was more like 2.5 years. And I was very impatient, but I had a lot to learn in that time. I just had so much to learn that I didn't know I needed to learn until it was God's time and God was right. I believe another reason he might have moved Elijah was so that Elijah couldn't mess up God's plan. You know, Abraham messed up God's plan. Abraham got ahead of the game, and he got his own ideas and thoughts in there, and he messed up the plan. Now, that doesn't mean God can't fix the plan. God will fix any mess you make. Don't worry about that. He'll take care of it. He'll work it around. He'll figure it out. He's not got any problems figuring things like that out. But he had to wait, and he did not like to wait. He wanted to be in the center of the action. But at Cherith, at the brook, he learned that God will provide every need that he had. He provided him. There was water there. The drought hadn't went on long enough. There was still water at the brook. The ravens fed him. It wasn't luxurious, but it met his needs, and he was there. And I believe he spent a lot of time in prayer. And boy, that's when you begin to get close to God. That's when you begin to see what God can do, and he begins to speak and deal in your life. He was beginning to prepare Elijah for the next step, and I'm not going to go into that story for the sake of time, but when he met the widow, he already knew God was going to provide. He'd been providing for him, so believing that the widow would have oil and flour was no big deal for him. He already knew what God could do. He'd already lived it. He'd already been there. He'd seen it for himself. That was a lesson he had learned. He learned the difference between necessity and luxury. He learned to be humbled by being pulled out of the center of attention. Some of us like to be the center of attention. And when it's not, we get a little pouty and we get a little mad and we don't know why it's that way. Why didn't Pastor ask me to do that? I'm the most experienced. Well, maybe you've got something else to learn. I don't know. We know later then what the big test was for Elijah, and that was meeting Ahab finally face to face. God says, go see Ahab. It's time. And all of this time, God's been preparing Elijah for the biggest battle of his life. Do I have some water up here? Would somebody get me some water, please? Thank you. I appreciate that. My sinuses are making me a little dry. I just encourage you to go read Kings because there's so much in there. He meets Obadiah, who was a prophet, and he was hiding prophets, and he sends word, you tell Ahab I'm coming, and Obadiah says, what do you want to do, get me in big trouble? Pastor Mike, I got something. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, thank you. Sorry, break. Commercial break. I encourage you to try pure aqua. Purified water will quench your thirst, refresh you in the heat of the day or whatever you're doing. I suggest you give it a try. That was our commercial. Okay. So here he is. He's got the big battle now. He's meeting Ahab. Jezebel's got 450 of her servants, and they're there, and you know the story. They begin to pray, and there's the altar built, and nothing happens, and the deal is whoever's God calls down the fire wins. Elijah's not worried about it. He's already seen God do so many things. Baal's prophets can't do anything. They begin to pray and pray, and Elisha gets a little full of himself. He says, where is your God? Is he sleeping? Is he in the bathroom? What's he doing? That's what he says. Is he relieving himself? Where's he at? They cut themselves. They do everything. Nothing happens. Elijah just prays. Fire falls. They've even wet it down. Everything's gone. The water, the altar, everything's gone. God's declared the God. Now, that's a lesson in waiting, okay? Now we're going to move to Joseph. We're going to tie it all together here in a minute. So now we go to Joseph. It's another famous, well-known story in the Bible. Joseph was sold by his brothers. Now put yourself in Joseph's place. He was sold by his family, or a few of them, not by Reuben. Reuben went back to get him, and he was gone. He's a slave now to Potiphar. Potiphar's wife tries to seduce him. He's put in prison. He's there years. And I want to read you something that he says. Now, if you can think about Joseph when he was young, he already had a call on his life. He knew he was going to be somebody because he had a dream and it said, your brothers are going to bow to you. He knew he had something great ahead in his life. I believe that. I believe he knew that God had a plan for him. He wasn't quite sure what it was yet, but he knew he had a call on his life. And I don't think in any of Joseph's plan would he have ever thought this was God's plan. I'm going to be betrayed by my brothers. I'm going to be a slave to Potiphar. His wife's going to try to seduce me. She's going to lie on me. I'm going to end up in prison. Wow, God, that's a great plan. That's great. I can't wait to fall into that plan. That's wonderful. Sign me up. We don't know what the plan is. We have no idea. In fact, Habakkuk was praying to God, and he was telling him about the sin and the evil. He said, what are you going to do? And God said, if I told you, you wouldn't believe me. If I told you, you wouldn't believe me. If God would have told Joseph, this is what's going to happen, Joseph might have went, really? If somebody would have told Pastor Larry at 14, you're going to pastor a church? When hell freezes over, maybe. That's probably what he'd have said, or worse. This is the truth. That's not the plan he had for his life. He didn't know the plan God had. Joseph had no idea what was coming. But look at what he says. Look at his life and you'll see that no matter how bad it got, guess what? He found favor everywhere he went. Why? Because he stuck to God's plan. Pastor Mike mentioned it today. Follow the precepts. Follow the law. Follow God's word. Do the things you know to do. And it doesn't matter what the situation is, God will bring you through it on top. You may still have to go through it, but where you go, you'll find favor. He will feed you in the presence of your enemies. He will prepare a table for you. And you may be surrounded by people who don't believe you, who don't like you, who don't trust you, but as long as God does, that's all that matters. Here's what he said. Potiphar's wife's coming after him. Now, he's a young man. Let's be realistic here. Here's the master's wife trying to get him in bed. I expect that might have been a temptation. But he says in verse 9 of chapter 39 in Genesis, there is none greater in this house than I. Neither hath he kept back anything from me but thee. He's talking about his master, Potiphar. He said, Potiphar promoted him. Right. I mean, you know, I suppose after a period of testing, he saw that Joseph was honorable, honest, trustworthy, and he promotes him, second only to the master of the house. And Joseph said, but the only thing he's kept back from me is you, because you're his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? I want you to ask yourself, I challenge you to do this. The next time you are presented with something, instead of just saying, nah, I don't want to, why don't you say, I don't want to sin against my God. You see the reaction you get. Karen, can you tweak those numbers a little bit? Because if the numbers don't line up to a certain percentage, we're not going to get the grant money we need. And we can do a lot of good with that grant money. You know we could. Yeah, we could. So that's all I need you to do. Now, I could say, well, you know what? I don't do that. Or I could say, you want me to sin against God? Can you imagine the reaction we would get? If when somebody asks you to do something wrong, teens, you're not in here, but will you cover for me? Because I'm going to say I'm over here, and when my mom calls, if one of them would say, you want me to sin against God? We want to deny doing something wrong, but we seriously, we get a little, I don't do that. That's illegal, or that's immoral. No, it's a sin against your God. It's a sin against the life you live and the representation you have of the God you serve to do that. And and I agree with Pastor, it's time we stand up and we say, I'm not going to do that because I'm not going to sin against God.
Not because it's illegal or immoral, that too, but because I have made a covenant with my God that I will not do that. And that's why I won't do what you're asking me to do. Hey, when they come by and want to buy this car and they ask about the transmission, you just tell them it's okay. You don't know if anything's wrong with it. You want me to sin against God? You may lose some friends, but you'll gain favor with God. He found favor everywhere he went. And there had to be moments that he was in the prison going, God, what's the meaning of this? What am I going through this for? What am I learning here? But there were things to learn. Because one day he became second under only Pharaoh. And how many times do you suppose he was asked, hey, for a little extra money, I'll give you a little extra grain. You give me a little extra grain, and I'll give you a little extra money. Little deal on the side, just like Potiphar's wife offered him. He learned a long time ago to say, I will not sin against God. He was presented with even bigger temptations, because the higher in power you go, the bigger the temptation becomes. You have a lot more authority. You have a lot more power. It's much easier for people to come and say, hey, you scratch my back and I'll scratch yours. We'll make this work for both of us. And he learned a long time ago to say, I will not sin against God. And it promoted him to a place of favor because he waited and he was patient. I probably wouldn't have been very patient, but I'm going to say that he was patient. Because there was a plan, there was a time that God had, and he was willing to wait on it. Let's look at Joshua. Now, I've got saved in 1974. I have probably read this scripture 100 times, but it was just like the other day that I went, the light bulb, you know, bing. Don't you love that? Because you think, well, heck, I've read everything in there, and then God will just go, no, you missed this little piece right here. So Joshua, talking about plans. Joshua was a great leader. He had faith and belief from the very beginning. He knew what God could do. And now God has said, here's the city before you. It's Jericho. I have no doubt that Joshua saw that and he began to plan in his mind. I wonder where the weak parts are. I wonder when the guards are the least. I wonder when the gate is open that we might be able to get somebody in there. I wonder if we could, you know. Now, I believe he's praying all the time. I think all this time he's praying and seeking God's face. But he's also planning and preparing. And that's a good thing to do. You should plan and prepare. You should have something laid out ahead of you. But you cannot escape putting God in there with it. You just can't. And here's why. I believe Joshua was praying. I believe he was seeking God's face and that he was planning. How do I get Jericho down? And in verse 13 of Joshua chapter 5, it says, and it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho that he lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, there stood a man over against him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went unto him and said unto him, art thou for us or for our adversaries? I don't know you. What are you doing here? Who are you for? Now, it depends on which translation you look at. And he said, nay. And another translation, it says, neither. Wait a minute. who are you for? Neither. But here's what he says next. But as the captain of the host of the Lord, am I now come. I just can't tell you what that does to me. When God steps into your plan, he's not there to answer your plan. He's there to bring his plan. Because his plan is perfect. His plan has all the correct answers. He'll move aside your plan, and some of your plan may line up with his. But when God shows up, it's not your plan he's there to fulfill. Don't get the big head and think you've done anything. God's already got it figured out, and God has shown up to bring his plan to pass, the perfect plan. And Joshua would have, what God has planned, you could not even begin to imagine. I could tell you, but you wouldn't believe it, he said to Habakkuk. He could have told Joseph, and Joseph would have never believed that would have happened. He could have told Jonah. He could have told all of the men of God. But I don't know that they could have ever conceived what God had in store. But they have to learn to say, God, your plan is the plan I want to show up. When God shows up in my life, he's brought his plan. That's the plan I want. Not my little feeble plan that I've plotted out. Oh, how am I going to get out of debt? Okay, let's see. I'll go to the pawn shop and I'll get rid of this and I'll sell that. I'll go see mom and dad. Maybe I can go to the payday loan place and I'm going to figure all this out. And God's got a plan you would have never dreamed was going to happen. And you've made all these plans. That's good. You should. I'm not telling you to just go, oh, well, I don't care. God expects you to pray and plan and have something going on and thinking about it. But don't be surprised when what happens had nothing to do with how you thought it was going to be. You better hope it doesn't. We're not smart enough to figure it out. I am not. What God does is so far above my pay grade. Not in my job description. I'm not expected to understand it. I don't need to understand it. All I need to know is that when God has a plan and he shows up, it will happen exactly as it's supposed to happen. Whether it's the coronavirus, bring it on. Bring it on. You think God's afraid of the coronavirus? No. Do we understand that? No. But you know what I've learned through all of that? I can survive pretty good with just me and the old man at home. I get along pretty good. My work world's turned upside down. Guess what? I've been all right. Not missed a day of work. I don't understand why God's... whether I don't know that God brought this on or this is the enemy. It doesn't really matter, does it? Doesn't matter how it got here or who, what the plan is. When God shows up, it'll be on the front page news that he is risen. Because God's got the plan. God knows what's going on. He's not surprised. He's not afraid. He's not shaken. Go to sleep at night. God's up all night anyway. Let him worry about it. Go to bed. Go to sleep. You don't have a thing to worry about. But we want to know the plan in the beginning, and you may not know that plan in the beginning. And again, if he told you, I don't know that you don't believe it or understand it. His ways are so far above ours. And when you look at these men of God, and what they went through and what they learned and what they progressed through and how they grew because God had an even bigger plan for them. So if you're sitting and waiting because God's promised you something, whether it's the salvation of your kids, whether it's the better job, whether it's a home, I don't know what it is. It could be anything. And you, about week three, you grow weary. Please don't. Please don't. Keep praying. Keep watching. Stay close to this. You wander away, you're going to be in bad trouble. It's going to take maybe some dangerous things to bring you back to where you need to be. I said this before. Michael McCann used to say, if prison brought you to Jesus, then prison's the best thing that ever happened to you. You know what? If you'd have told somebody that was the plan, they'd have said, I don't want that plan. Take my name off the list. But if that's the plan God has or whatever has happened, God will take that event and turn it around to his good. He will change the move. He says he takes what's crooked and makes it straight, and he takes what's straight and he makes it crooked. He will make it to your advantage and to your best to fit his plan, not yours, because he will come up with a solution you would have never dreamed of. Joshua would have never thought, hey, I bet if we march around, it'll fall down. That's our plan. For some reason, I just don't think that's what his plan was. He was thinking of a natural way to defeat. He's thinking in the natural. How do we get in there and do this? All the time in prayer, all the time thinking about it, all the time asking God. And when the time was right, God's solution was something he would have never dreamed of. God is not bound by natural things. He is not bound by the laws of nature. He's not bound by the laws of the land. He's not bound by our small minds. He's got a plan, and when he shows up, I've just went on that for about 3 weeks now. I'm with the army of God. I've just shown up. Well, then you take over. You got the plan. Let's go for it. Because God's showing up. You know, I looked this up, and this may not mean, you know, people have different ways of thinking, but I use Strong's Concordance a lot. And I looked up the word plan. Do you know it's not in Strong's Concordance? It's not. God doesn't need to plan. Planning implies thinking through it to a solution. Planning implies figuring out what I'm going to do next. Planning implies some needed action on my part to make something happen. That's not God. God just says, here it is. God didn't have to plan the creation. He said, there it is. God didn't have to plan. There it was. Those are our words. Those are our thoughts. That's the way we think of things. I got to plan this out. I got to think about it. I got to figure it out. And you should. I want you to. I want to do that. I'm going to tell you a really quick story about Wolf and I were talking about this the other day. When we first went to work at RCA, I would often get laid off because I was, had the lowest seniority. And he'd been there a couple years more than me, so he didn't get laid off, but I did. And we were young and broke, just like every other young couple. We didn't have any money. But we had gotten saved in 1974. We just hadn't been married very long. And we were taught tithing. We were just taught by the Word of God that you pay your tithe. And so we were very faithful in that. We also gave alms and offerings. We learned a long, long time ago that you can't outgive God. You just can't. It's not going to happen. And when we got laid off, we were like, boy, we're kind of broke. Tithe was never on the table. Never. It was never on the table. My lights will be shut off first. We'll go to the food bank. I don't believe that'll happen because I believe God will keep his word and be faithful. But alms and offering could have been on the table. So we talked about it. We said, I don't even remember what we were giving at the time. It wasn't any huge amount because we weren't making that much money, but we were giving something. So we began to plan. We said, well, okay, we could not give to our missions, which was an orphanage in India. Maybe we could not. We had a campground then also. Maybe we could not give that little bit we give to the campground because, we're broke. We're broke. Now, I admit it was probably me saying that. We're broke. We're broke. All the time praying, God, what do you want us to do? What's the plan here, God? How do you want us to handle this? Always planning, following the word. God, we're not touching tithe. That's yours. Mm-mm, don't want that curse. So one day I went to the refrigerator and I opened it up, and this was not a verbal voice, but the Spirit of God can speak so loud. And it was like God said, you have a 2-liter bottle of pop. You're not broke. Oops. Well, it's our perspective of things. In India, the luxury of a 2-liter bottle of pop was like bread and water for months. And I'm thinking I'm broke. I can't give but I've still got a 2-liter bottle of pop in the refrigerator. Wow. We talked about it. We said, you know what? We'll do without the 2-liter bottle of pop. We're going to go ahead and give to our missions like we always have. We've committed to it. If anybody does without, it's going to be us. We'll do without because our broke is 10 times better than their best. I still had a roof. I still had clothing. I still had the ability to go to a doctor. I still had gas in my car. I mean, I had a lot of good things going on that they didn't even dream of. So if anybody's going to do without, it's going to be us. And that's the commitment we made. We planned, we prayed, and we made a decision. To this day, I have never opened my refrigerator and not had a 2-liter bottle of pop. When God shows up, he'll show up in the layoff, he'll show up in the hospital, he'll show up wherever you are. When the commander of the army of God comes and shows up, you have nothing to worry about. One more scripture, and then I'm going to shut up. I love this scripture too. 2 Kings 6:15. When the servant of the man of God had risen early and was gone forth, behold, a host compassed the city, both with horses and chariots. And his servant said unto him, alas, my master, what shall we do? What's the plan? Oh, what's the plan, Elisha? This is now the next man after Elijah. Elisha, they're surrounded. The enemy is there. What's the plan, Elisha? What are we going to do? You got to come up with a plan. What are we going to do? Is there a way out? Is there an escape route? Is there a tunnel we can get under? Can we camouflage ourselves? Can we ride sideways on the horses like the cowboys do and run past them? What's the plan, Elisha? And he said, "Fear not, for they that be with us are more than they that be with them." And Elisha prayed and said, "Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes that he may see." And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw. And behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire round about Elisha. You know what Elisha's plan was? Lord, open his eyes. That's the only plan he needed. Lord, open his eyes. Let him see. Let him see. Come to find out, if you read on again, that everything was fine. It all turned out just fine. God took care of it. Elisha didn't need a plan. His plan was open his eyes that he may see. I just encourage you to plan. If you're in a place that you feel like I have waited and waited and waited, and what's happening, God, don't stop now. You don't know God's plan, and you will never know God's plan till the end. I have had a lot of things happen, and at the time I thought, what in the world was this about? But I can look back and go, oh, that's what that was about. Had God told me the plan at the time, I don't know that I would have even believed it, because my mind is too small to comprehend how big God is, really. I try to tell myself I know how big he is, but I really don't know how big he is. I really cannot comprehend that, a God that just speaks and things happen. That's hard for me to grasp, because that's not the natural world I live in. So if you're waiting on that salvation for a child, if you're waiting on a change in whatever your situation is, do what these men did. Keep following what you know to do, which is the Word of God. Don't stray from it. Stay true to it. Joseph, I believe, stayed true to God through everything he went through. And because of it, the plan came to pass. He was second under Pharaoh. But it wasn't always an easy place to get to. Lean on the Word. Listen to what God has to say. Plan. Talk about it. Think about it. Make sure your plan lines up with this. If you think you're going to get a plan that goes around this, you're doomed from the beginning. If your plan is to cheat, forge documents, lie, to get you out of trouble, drop that plan right now and say, "I will not sin against God. I'm going to stay on the path." Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word, and I thank you for the plan that you have in our lives. It's a plan that we cannot even begin to comprehend or understand. But I know that whatever happens, you have the answer. And your army of God is waiting to move. It is waiting on you to give the word, and the army of God will come in. The Spirit of God will sweep down, and the plan will begin to happen. And it will happen just as the right way to do it. It will happen just as you have commanded it. Not the enemy, not politicians, not lawyers, not bosses and unions, but what you want, God, will be the outcome, because you have the plan. You have the correct answer. You have everything that we need. And I thank you for that. And I ask it in Jesus' name. If there's something that you have been waiting on, I'm going to encourage you for you to just come and pray like we did this morning. I think sometimes we depend on prayer partners to take us to the throne, when really we just need to go to the throne. We don't need an intercessor. I think it's great if you want to come find a prayer partner, but sometimes it's best that you just hit the altar and you and God talk about it. Yes. You and God figure it out. Amen. Because guess what? I don't know what the plan is either. If you come and ask me to pray about your plan, I'm going to say, "God, you should show them what the plan is," because I certainly don't have any idea. I just encourage you to come. If there's something that hasn't happened that you've been waiting on, turn your plans over to God. He'll show up just on time. Not just in time, on time.
One touch of your I am healed and I am whole. Jesus, one glimpse of your face brings fire.
Jesus.
That as we draw nigh to you, Lord, that you draw nigh to us. And Lord, that's what your word does, Lord God. Lord, it's like a fire shut up in our bones, Lord God, and it draws us to the heart of God. And we thank you for that, Lord. We thank you for what we've heard this morning. Hallelujah. Lord, if we have a plan, you're the plan, Lord God. Our plan is to seek your face, Lord. Our plan is to allow you to open our eyes, Lord, to the truth, Lord, to your mercy, to your grace, Father God. Lord Jesus, we thank you this morning, Father God, for stirring our hearts with your word, Father God. Lord God, as we leave this place, Lord God, we want to continue, Lord God, to lift up the name of Jesus, compelling others to come in, to know you, Lord. Lord God, to humble themselves, to call upon your name. And receive that name that's above every name, Acts 4:12 says. There's a name, hallelujah, no other name. It's a name, no other name under heaven given among men, whereby we must be saved. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we love you. Father, we give you praise and glory. Lord God, in the wonderful name of Jesus. And all of God's people said, amen, amen, amen. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.